But the good thing about science is that it never solves a problem without creating 10 more. And the biggest problem that you all guys are currently facing in your respective fields is data. Because we are living in a data revolution today. So the world digital data was computed to be in 2012 as 2.75 zettabytes, and this will increase to 8 zettabytes in 2015. Now, an approximate 500 petabytes of this data is healthcare data, which will also increase in 2020 tremendously. And out of this healthcare data, the data that really looks interesting to me is literature-based data, so PubMed data. And if you see this number, it's also increasing from the year 2004. I made this search on keyword Alzheimer's disease, and you see the number of Alzheimer's-based articles popping up in the literature from 2004 to 2013, and in 2014, it's already catching up with the trend. Now, if you zoom into this trend of data, literature data, you will find two kinds of trends existing in there. So two kinds of knowledge, basically. So one is emerging knowledge, and one is established knowledge. So what I mean by established knowledge is that things which has been known, so like APP plays a role in the disease. This was once speculated, but eventually now it's been made clear that, okay, this actually plays a role. But apart from this established knowledge, there are a lot of candidates present in the literature which are being still speculated to play a role in the disease. And so we were interested in taking out these candidates which are speculated in literature. So we started off with the purpose of our research was to get an overview of current speculation or the candidates or the proteins or genes which has been speculated to play a role in a particular stage of Alzheimer's disease. And second, to construct state-specific networks for Alzheimer's disease and predict potential emerging biomarkers possible for early stage of Alzheimer's disease. Now, how do we do that? So just to give a brief overview of my strategy, so we designed an Alzheimer's disease ontology and also a strategy called Hypothesis Finder, which finds speculations existing in text. We combined both of them in our text mining knowledge retrieval tool called Skyview, and this combination gave us particular proteins which have been speculated to play a role in a particular stage of Alzheimer's disease. Finally, using these proteins, we constructed state-specific networks and inferred biomarkers out of the state-specific networks. Zooming into detail of each one of these steps, so Alzheimer's disease ontology, the current draft has 1,600 odd concepts with around 1,200 synonyms. What I mean by a synonym in ontology is that supposedly some people write amyloid precursor protein, others write APP, or APP can be written in 40 different forms in literature, so we try to cover all of these forms existing. So this is an example showing how this particular ontology works and how this particular ontology annotates and retrieves information within Skyview. One of the experiments, apart from that, we did with this ontology is that we look for comorbidities. We mine some electronic health patient records existing, and we found out for comorbidity investigation, and we found out that there are four comorbidities which are existing in Alzheimer's disease, which includes diabetes, hypertension, stroke, and heart trauma. Now, Hypothesis Finder was the second strategy that we designed. So this was basically collecting the patterns that everybody used to speculate in literature, like maybe, might be involved, might influence, may favor, and so on. And this is how actually it works in literature. So it tries to annotate the catch the key phrase, which is used to represent speculation in text, and derive the speculation out existing in literature. Now, we are just not interested in speculations. We are interested in state-specific speculations. So that's why we use this combination within Skyview, which is Human Genes and Protein Dictionary plus Hypothesis Finder plus Alzheimer's disease ontology. So Hypothesis Finder basically tags the hyperspeculative pattern. Alzheimer's disease ontologies go for tracking retrieval of particular stage of Alzheimer's disease and so on. So in this way, we derive speculations belonging to a particular stage of Alzheimer's disease. So far, we get 289 hypotheses belonging to mild stage of Alzheimer's disease, 101 to moderate stage, and 182 to severe stage of Alzheimer's disease. If you put a little bit of more statistics onto that, so there are around 50% of the hypothesis existing for mild stage of Alzheimer's disease. So we can say that still people don't know how the Alzheimer's disease is starting, so still they are speculating a lot about the mild stage of Alzheimer's disease. This also goes for the particular proteins which are speculated to play a role in Alzheimer's disease. Now, since we love to benchmark in science, we benchmarked our system with ALS1 knowledge base, and as you can see, in this case, our retrieval in terms of number of hypotheses was 10 times more than what was present in ALS1, and also with respect to proteins, 5 times more retrieval. So this is more or less first part of the story where we retrieve hypotheses which are belonging to particular stage of Alzheimer's disease. Next is we wanted to build state-specific network for Alzheimer's disease. So we already have a bigger network of Alzheimer's disease, which we have found out by curating literature. What we did is that we took the speculative proteins for each stage of Alzheimer's disease, and we mapped it onto an Alzheimer's disease network to generate mild, moderate, and severe stage Alzheimer's disease networks separately. So, and all of these networks, as you can see, are further annotated by, okay, what are the hypotheses supporting this particular network? Okay, what kind of experiment was done to validate this protein-protein interaction and so on. So once we had this state-specific Alzheimer's disease networks, we wanted to know, okay, out of this state-specific networks, particularly in early stage of Alzheimer's disease where people don't know much, how many of these candidates are actually speculated or considered as biomarkers. So what we did is that, again, we mined literature with the help of a biomarker terminology, and we looked for sentences where a particular candidate has been mentioned or speculated as biomarker for Alzheimer's disease. So like supposedly decreased TRK gene expression in chorogenic neurons or expression level of COX-1 may change in AD brain. So in this way, we derived candidates which have been considered as biomarker for Alzheimer's disease. And once we had these candidates, what we did is that we took the early stage network and we mapped this candidate onto this network. So the green one mentioned here are known potential biomarkers. So there is no an absolutely FDA-approved biomarker for Alzheimer's disease so far, but still there are a lot of biomarkers which are on the verge. So based on the number of evidences existing in literature supporting a biomarker, the green one we say are the biomarkers which have been considered or which are known valid potential biomarker for Alzheimer's disease. So if you go to an expert, they will say, okay, yeah, this makes more sense. What about the red one? So red one are basically new probable biomarkers or the biomarkers which are speculated in literature so far. And there is not much confidence. So either they are new, so just predicted in 2012 or 2013 and so on. There is not much community confidence so far in terms of new probable candidates. Now, out of this all new probable candidates, we further filtered this candidate by using gene expression analysis, and we found out of all of these candidates, 4 of the candidates which are shown to be differentially expressed in early stage of Alzheimer's disease. So once we found these candidates supported by gene expression data, so LRPA, CTS, PGRM1, LDLR, now, we basically wanted to model the biology existing around this candidate. So how can we say that, okay, this particular candidate is contributing to early AD? So we use biological expression language, BEL, and we model biology around this particular candidate. And what we found out in terms of causal reasoning is that supposedly LRP8, which is a receptor for reelin, and in normal human being, reelin normally antagonizes beta amyloid production, but since LRP8 is impaired in case of Alzheimer's disease, so this antagonization function is somehow stopped, which leads to Alzheimer's disease, so more of to inference out of this particular model. So coming to my research outcome, finally, I can say that hypothetical pattern existing in text could be retrieved and linked to molecular signatures, as we showed with the hypothesis finder approach. The hypothesis finder approach in this case, we try to model it, apply it in terms of Alzheimer's disease, but this can be applied to any further domain, cancer, malaria, or X domain. And further, we report the generation of state-specific hypothesis-linked networks, which relates clinical feature of AD to underlying molecular events, and also, as we say, aids in biomarker discovery. So since I started off with data, I will also conclude with data. Mining pyramid. So this is a particular data mining pyramid which has 4 levels: data, information, knowledge, and decision. And if you go up the value increases. If you go down, the volume increases. And what we did in this study is also that we wanted to get value out of our work. So we had initial publication data, which was available. With the help of Alzheimer's disease ontology and the hypothesis finder strategy, we derive information or the speculations existing in literature about particular candidate speculated as biomarkers. So this was more of deriving information out of data. When we constructed state-specific networks for Alzheimer's disease, we converted this information into knowledge, and when we came up further after filtering the candidates for biomarkers, we came up with a decision. So this should be the goal of every computational biologist, to be going this way up, increasing the value, which is not easy, but as they say, that it's always easy to go down the hill than to climb up, but the view is always better at the top. Thanks a lot for listening.
Okay, we have time for questions. And please say your name and your institution as you ask your question.
I am Matthew Scotch from Arizona State University. That was a really nice talk.
Thank you so much.
A question I had was, when you mapped the biological entities to your network, your subnetwork, were there any that didn't map?
Yes.
Okay.
So we only considered the one that mapped, so there were a lot that didn't map. Because we never know how complete and correct our particular Alzheimer's disease network is.
Yeah, so what did the ones that didn't map tell you about your networks?
So it is also a way to characterize or validate our network. So in a way it can say that the network is so far not complete, or this information about protein-protein interaction doesn't exist in the literature so far. Thank you.
Andrew Cowley from Amberley BI. I was just wondering, when you take literature as a starting point, do you find that there's some kind of self-reinforcement, as in once a protein's mentioned in literature, you're likely to find more literature mentioning the same protein because it's been mentioned before and people are checking and so on?
So this is what I talk about, the trend. So supposedly, if you just look at APP articles, the Alzheimer literature, if there are 90,000 or 100,000 articles, I think 40,000 will be biased towards APP. And APP once mentioned in 1990 a speculated candidate, and overall it grew, and 2014 is very well established. But that's why we did this approach, because we wanted to move from the zone of established knowledge to emerging knowledge. So look apart from the usual suspects that's found in there, and that's why that was the goal of this approach, to look for candidates either which were lost, so one candidate which was predicted in 1999, but nobody followed that trend, although it looks interested, or there is a candidate appearing in 2013 that looks really interesting and should be followed.
Yeah, sort of second part was, do you take into the sort of negative linking from the literature as well? So someone's mentioning proteins that are being ruled out as well.
Sorry?
Do you take into account a negative link in the literature as well, so that associations that have been ruled out from experiments and so on, and does that get built into your...
We build it based on the confidence, so supposedly if there are... first of all, there is very less negative data that is available in literature.
Yeah.
So if overall there is not much negative data saying that these two proteins doesn't interact. But this network that I generated is also based on the confidence of a particular edge. Supposingly that, okay, if APP interacts with BAC1, how many separate studies are saying that this actually interact? And also just not based on studies, okay, what experiment was done for this validation? Was it done in vivo? Was it done in vitro? Was it just a yeast to hybrid experiment? So when we build this protein-protein interaction network, we took that into account. And if supposedly there is a negative interaction existing, we weigh that also.
Thank you.
Great. We have time for a few more questions, but I'll hog it if we have no other questions. So feel free to come up if a question occurs to you. An exercise that I go through often is I'll do an analysis of some sort, produce a list of genes, and it's for a particular purpose. And quite often, the people I'm working with will know well the literature for their list of genes, and they'll see their usual suspects, and then they'll see something that pops out at them that they haven't noticed before. And the next exercise becomes, okay, what are those genes involved in other diseases? And it occurs to me that your hypothesis finder could potentially be augmented, not only finding hypotheses within Alzheimer's itself, but to look outside the disease area and ask, what other hypotheses are these genes involved with? Have you thought about that?
So as I mentioned, as one of the conclusion of this talk, that we applied the hypothesis finder strategy basically for Alzheimer's disease, but this is absolutely independent. As long as there is text, there is a pattern of speculation existing, it will find it out.
Well, so I'll rephrase my question, because suppose my goal is to learn about Alzheimer's, but something comes up there, and let's assume that reelin hasn't been connected to Alzheimer's yet. Now I want to know more about it. It seems to me it would be of use to know what other hypotheses about reelin for any other disease are out there to bring back to the Alzheimer's.
All right, I get it now. So in SkyView, the tool which is managing speculation or hypothesis finder is input into the SkyView, you can also choose the context of the disease in which you wanted to derive speculations. So if you choose Alzheimer's disease plus and maybe cancer or something, it will pop up with the literature where these two, the particular speculations where there is a disease mention of Alzheimer's and cancer or something, and a role that really in place. So this is manageable within SkyView.
So in particular for Alzheimer's, it might be really interesting to add to that inflammation and inflammatory and
yeah.
See what starts to come up.
Surely.
Because that would expand your next view. Do we have any other questions? All right, well, let's thank this speaker, and we'll take a couple minutes to set up the next speaker.
Thank you so much.